Are you ready for God's word? That's more like it. Yes. Especially since we're talking about the importance and the beauty of God's word today. Can I just say something to you, church? I am so proud of you. We have an amazing church that just loves God's word. I mean, I can sense it on you. I hear it in the advice you give one another. I hear it in the prayers you offer for each other. I see it in the way that you lead your families and the way you share with your neighbors and your loved ones. Can I tell you, you're here and you're ready for God's word, and that tells me that you revere it. You value it. And I just want to say, way to go, because God's word is so important, and the teaching of God's word is the most important thing you can do, you can engage in, to understand God's word, because today we're going to talk about how God's word is not ordinary. Not only is it not ordinary, it's supernatural, and it's living. It's got power to change your life. And so if you're here today and you need some help in some areas of your life, I want you to know you've come to the right place, and the answer really is in God's word. The answer really is in God's word. So I want you to start thinking even now, what is the area of my life that I could level up in? How can I experience more prosperity in this particular facet or this particular area, this particular category of what I'm doing? And I want you to know that it's in God's word. And you say, but Pastor, how could this small book cover so much? Because you're thinking too narrow-mindedly. Whoa, what do you mean narrow-minded? You're thinking in terms of one dimension. But this is supernatural. This is not just the physical dimension that we're talking about here. We're talking about God in his infinite wisdom and power is able to write a book, and his word says it's living. Therefore, whatever facet, wherever your life finds itself, wherever, whatever circumstance or situation might be unfolding, it's living and it's applicable right there. Right there. And so what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to raise your opinion of God's word right here, right now, before we get started. I want you to know this is not a bestseller. This is not just some ancient text. This is not like a great magazine or a self-help book. This is the mighty, awesome, infallible, inerrant word of the living God. Of the living God. And so when you take it that way, it will change your life. And so if you're ready, then I want to get into it by saying the word of God is light. The word of God is light. Think about this with me. In the book of Genesis, God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. So I want to draw a connection for you. God speaks, or his word brings forth light. Did you see that? He spoke and light happened. Therefore, this word will bring light to your life. This word will bring light to your life. John picks up this very same idea in 1 John. I want to remind you of what John said. He said, "In the beginning was the word." Now, he's wanting to parallel the way he started off 1 John with the way Moses started off Genesis. What was the first verse in Genesis? In the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. All things were created by him, right? And then he goes to this verse and he says, "Let there be light." Well, if you take John's gospel, he says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. All things were created for him and by him." And then he goes on to say, "In him was life, and the life was the light of men." Did you get that? So in the beginning, God said, "Let there be light." In the beginning was the Word. That means Jesus Christ was there creating. And by the Word, the Son, things were created. Now watch this. "And in him was life, and this life was light." So this word is life and light for your life. That's what I'm here to tell you. This word is light and life for your life. Amen? And so light for your life is the title of this message. Light for your life. Not just inside, but outside. And not just outside, but inside. And what comes first, the light inside or the light outside? It's kind of like the chicken and the egg, right? Well, we'll talk about that as we go along, but I want you to know that this is why the Bible, and one of my favorite verses, because it was my grandfather's favorite verse, my grandfather on my mother's side, in fact, when I went off to college, my mother bought me a little, like a little sailboat-looking plaque thing, and it said this verse on it, and the verse is, "Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path." Now, I just said a mouthful. Did you catch that? "Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path." And this was my grandfather's favorite verse, and so I kept it, and it's become one of my favorite verses. And it was my mom's way of saying, hey, you're leaving the house for the first time, and you're going to be on your own, but don't be on your own. Take God's word with you. Take God's word with you, amen? And she was saying this to me. She was saying, hey, not only can God guide your entire life, your path, but he can also guide your step. Because how many of you know that you can have an amazing 20-year plan, but if you're messing up in your steps, you're never going to get to your 20-year plan. But if you keep your steps right, then you can accomplish and get to where you're going. And what God's word is saying, not only can I give you illumination for your life, but I can help you in your day-to-day decisions right now where you're at in this moment. In this moment. How important is it to understand where you're going and to have illumination? It's super important. How important is it to have illumination, not just way out in the distance, but right here in front? Is it possible to have a light shining way out there and yet step on a snake right here? In fact, that almost happened to Raquel. She came yesterday. I was working out because I've been working out. I know you can't tell yet. But I was told it takes about 3 months for you to tell, 6 months for your friends to tell, and about a year for the world to tell. Amen. That's where I'm headed. Jace was encouraging me with that. I was like, 3 months? I don't got 3 months. I'm going to go with 1 month. Amen. But I'm working out, and I'm on the bike, and all of a sudden, I'm right next to my garage door. I probably shouldn't be telling you this, because then you're going to come do the same thing. I do carry it at times, so don't come sneaking up on me like Raquel did. She's right next to where I'm working out. The garage door has a little window, and she goes, she had this creepy look, and I just, oh my goodness, my heart rate was already up. And then she says, I should have gotten that on video. And I'm like, what are you doing? And she goes, I almost stepped on a snake. I go, how do you do that? She says, it's dark outside. It's dark outside. I need to carry a flashlight with me. Can I tell you, some of us need to understand that God's word is the flashlight so that when we walk, we don't step on the ploys of the enemy that are there to hurt us and harm us in different ways, shapes, and forms. You go, what do you mean different ways, shapes, and forms? In the people that he wants you to associate with, in the advice he wants you to take from them, in the attitudes that you have a propensity to fall into, either anger or competition or envy or jealousy. Do you hear what I'm saying? It's a snake. It's something that wants to bite you. It's something that wants to harm you. It's something that wants to destroy your life. And God is saying, I can illuminate that for you. I can give you light to see what he's up to so that you can go around it, over it, or just plain kill it. Amen? Or just, some of you are going, no, let's be nice to the snakes. Let's keep going. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. In fact, this reminds me of a story I heard once, and it was back in the day, and there was a farmer and a rancher, and he had several hired hands, and one of his hands was constantly using the lantern, and using a lot of oil to go call on his girl, and he was courting a girl, and he would walk down to her place and then take her from her place into town, and they would walk along the road, and he had a light so that he could have a lot of illumination and know exactly where he was going. And the rancher's getting frustrated with him, and he says, "You know, when I was younger, I never had to use a light. In fact, I never used a light when I went calling on my wife and when I went courting." And his hired hand says, "Yes, sir. Did you hear what I'm saying?" He says, "Yes, sir, and it shows." I want you to think about that for a second. Some of you are going, "What? What? Huh? Huh?" He put down Mrs. Rancher at the same time. He put down, because what I'm trying to tell you is that you need light. You need light, and light gives you confidence. Not only does it give you confidence, but it keeps you from harming yourself in moving about in your daily life. The other day, Pastor Melissa was cleaning up her, spring cleaning her closet. Anyone done your spring cleaning yet? And so as she was doing her spring cleaning, and can I tell you that sometimes it's a process. And so you might start the spring cleaning one day, but you'll get it done maybe another day. And so in that process, the bins, the big totes with all the clothes that you're putting up and the clothes you're bringing down are out. That's not so good if you wake up in the middle of the night and you've got to traverse and make it from your bed to the icebox to get some water. And so I hit that thing so hard, I thought I broke all my toes. And it took everything I had to just like, don't say a word. If only I had had some light. And you see, I love sleeping pitch black, as dark as I can get it. Anyone else? If there's a light on, it just bothers me. I got to cover them all up. And I like it dark. And that's good for sleeping. It's not good for... See, some of you need to understand that the darkness is good for sleeping. It's not good for moving about. And crazy things happen in darkness. You cannot make the decisions you are supposed to be making for your children, for your wife, for your life, for your husband, for your job, for your career, where you should live, where you should move, what you should buy, what you should save for, what you should pay off. And so many times we're wondering, "Lord, what's wrong? God, won't you bless me? God, won't you do more? God, won't you do more?" And God is saying, "I've given you all you need to supernaturally charge your life if you would just trust me in it." But you're stumbling around. And I'm not just preaching to you. I'm right there with you. Because everything I'm saying, I've got to remind myself of. Come on, how many of us know God has this amazing plan for us? And today is meant to excite you and to say, you know what? Flip some lights on. Open up God's word. Let's get the blessing that God has called out for us. Amen? Let's get this amazing blessing. After all, the Bible says, "Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, or stands in the path of sinners, or sits in the seat of the scornful." Now, how do you know who is walking in the counsel of ungodly? Because to walk, that means you've got to be discerning enough to know that's what? That's ungodly. The way we get discernment is in his word. But watch what it says. You've got to be able to discern what's ungodly, right? What's sin and what's scornful. If not, you'll find yourself progressing in this. First you walk by, then you what? Window shop. Isn't that true? And then once you window shop, you're just all up in the club. Hey, oh, hey. Am I right? Some of you are going, "No." I've lived it. How did I live it? Well, keep going on this verse. Verse number 2, watch what it says in verse 2. It says, "But his delight is in the law of the Lord." Uh-oh. His delight is in the law of the Lord. "And on his law he meditates day and night." Now watch this. "He shall be like a tree planted
by the rivers of water, streams of waters, and he will bring forth fruit in season. His leaves will not wither, and he shall prosper. He shall prosper. And so what happened to me, I grew up in my daddy's church, and I used to hear him preach the word so often that I began to despise it instead of delight in it. Notice what the condition is. Delight in the Lord, in the law of the Lord. Delight, that means I love it, I revere it, I can't wait to get more of it. I want to eat it all up. Is there anyone here that could honestly say, don't raise your hand, but is there anyone here who could honestly say, I don't really delight in it? I like other things way more. I like my phone, I like sports, I like this, I don't really love this, but you want to prosper, don't you? Isn't it funny how we want God's presence, we don't want his presence? You go, what's the difference? His presence are, I want to unwrap your goodness in my life. I want you to bring me a big old box, but I want you to do it Amazon style. Do it and just drop it off at my front door and ring the doorbell so I know it was there, and then go, like leave. I don't want you hanging around, Lord, because when you hang around, it makes me feel uncomfortable. Let's just be honest. It makes me feel uncomfortable. You get up all in my business, and you start wanting me to do this, that, and the other, and wanting me to change things, and you start bringing conviction, and you start bringing reproof, and you start bringing correction, and you start doing things that I don't really like. So I'd rather you bring me a present, put it on the front door, and leave my life alone so that I can do what I want. And when I need you, I'll say, Jesus, take the wheel. If he was already there behind the wheel, you wouldn't have to go, Jesus, take the wheel. Some of you go, huh? But that ruins the whole song. That's why you shouldn't get your theology from Nashville country music. Amen? Amen. This is what I'm trying to get us to understand. Is that God's word will get into our lives. You said, but I thought it was on the outside. But in order to illuminate the outside, he has to illuminate the inside and give you eyes to see and ears to hear in a spiritual manner. Amen. And in order to do that, he will bring presence that you will unfold, unwrap, and discover. But it's through his presence that he brings his presence. Amen. It's through him being there that he brings the blessing. And we have to delight in it. And when we don't delight in it, this is what happens. I was a young man once who scorned his word. Who was what? Frustrated at his word. That didn't delight in his word. And so then I went out with my friends trying to forget that God had to be my influence. And at first we just drove by the club. We walked by. And then it wasn't good enough to drive by. We had to park in the parking lot with a bunch of other cars. Come on, you know what I'm talking about? Over on Westheimer and on Richmond Avenue in Houston. And you're there with all the nightlife, and you're outside, and you're like, yeah, yeah. And then before long, you're just like, let's just go in. Yeah, hey, And you go, what does that have to do with something? It has to do with everything because my life changed for the worst. And I'm going, what's going on, Lord? Why aren't you more involved? He said, you left me. I didn't leave you. Get back in my word and your heart will change. You say, can his word really change my heart? Absolutely. This is what I want you to do. You start reading it and you say, Lord, give me a delight for your word. Help me fall in love with your word. Help me to see the supernatural power and the love letter you have written to me, Lord. Help me to see that by the power of your spirit right here, right now. I just open myself to you. Amen? I open myself to you. We're talking about spiritual things here. Spiritual things here. Amen? Outside and in. That's why the Bible says, thy word I have hidden in mine heart that I may not sin against thee. So take it. Take this for instance. He's saying, I want to delight in it in such a way that I hide it in my heart. It's so important to me. I keep it at the nearest, most dearest place to me. That's how important this word is to me.
Everything else can fail, but your word shall never fail me, Lord. Amen. I have hidden thy word in my heart that I may not sin against you. And then therefore, there's a discernment going on there. We'll talk more about it. Because the heart is what starts to change. Watch, when you start reading God's word. You're saying, wait a minute. Then therefore, the inside will affect the outside. You got it? See, what starts happening in here gives you eyes to discern and to perceive and to make decisions out here. That's what we're talking about here. And you're telling me, Pastor, if I understand you correctly, that this is supernatural, that this is spiritual, and it has power to do that? I'm not just telling you that, I'm guaranteeing it. It's absolutely true. You know why? Because I've lived it. And if you've lived it, would you just give testimony with me? It changes things. It changes things. And the enemy knows that. And so he'll do anything he can to steal it from your heart. Now watch this. In the book of Luke, chapter 6, verse 44, Jesus said this, "For every tree is known by its own fruit. For men do not gather figs from thorns, nor do they gather grapes from bramble bushes. A good man out of the good treasure of his heart brings forth good, and an evil man out of the evil treasure of his heart brings forth evil. For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks." And so he's basically saying this, look, God's word can change your heart. And when your heart is changed and it's flowing with the living water of his word, it shows up in everything you do, in every decision you make, in every circumstance you find yourself in. Does that mean every circumstance is good? No. But he says this, I'll work it out for your good. I'll take what this world is giving you, and I'll take that lemon and make a lemonade for you. I'll do something wonderful. I can work what the enemy has meant for evil for good. Can anyone say, I need that? This is why he said, I want to make you a tree that bears good fruit. And I'm going to plant you beside a stream of living water. Therefore, when times get tough, you're not what? You're not in trouble, nor are you withering. You're going to keep on keeping on because my word will sustain you. My word will be the wisdom that flows in you and through you. After all, he goes on to say, above all things, in his word, above all things, guard your heart. And how do you guard your heart? Why do you guard your heart? Well, he says, because everything flows from your heart. This is why David has said, I delight in it. I meditate in it, and I hold it in my heart. So that from there, good flows. Because this will govern my life. If you're here today and you're saying, I don't know if I've been there, Pastor. To be honest, I don't know if I've been there. You can be there. Can I ask you a question? Do I have more access to his word than you do? Do I have more privilege to his word than you do? Are you sure? But I'm a pastor. There was once a time where people thought that. And there was a church that controlled his word. There was a church that controlled his word. And people were in a dark age. And in this dark age, the priest would tell them, oh, you can't read Latin, therefore we'll tell you and we'll divvy out what we want you to know. And it was a form of manipulation and control. But because of God's word, and because great men of faith were inspired by that word, they got it out to the masses and they paid with their life. They paid with their life, and it was held dear for those that had read it for the first time. But maybe like me, you and I have taken it for granted as I took my father's messages for granted. And we have the word, but we don't really have the word. Does that make sense? And this is why Solomon says, guard the word in your heart. After all, for God's word in Hebrews 4 is living and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even the division of soul and spirit, joints and marrow. You say, what does that mean? Look at it very close with me. He's saying this. Because it's a supernatural book from God, it has the power to get in there and discern, help you discern what needs to be worked on. Is it a spiritual issue? Soul and spirit. Soul is emotions. Is it your emotions? Is it your mind? Is it something going on in your soul state? Or is it a spiritual matter? Then look at the next line. Joints and marrow. Is it a physical matter? Is it a physical matter? You're dealing with lust. And yes, you can deal with it spiritually, but let's also deal with it physically. The Bible says, lock it down. Lock it down how? Well, if your hand causes you to sin, cut it off. And so if you're dealing with lust, maybe it's also not just praying about it, not just reading God's word and saying, give me liberty over it. How about this? Stop going to the bar. Stop. If you're dealing with alcohol, if you're dealing with lust, then you shut down your access to the internet. You shut down who can access you. You get rid of it. You go, but it's hard. So is cutting your hand off. Right? Jesus said, pluck your eye out. That's hard too. I think I'd rather get rid of my internet. Amen? And so this is what the Bible will begin to help you with, because it's strong enough to discern and to help you in your weakest area. In your weakest area. Amen? This is why the Bible says this. Do not let them depart from your eyes. Keep them in the midst of your heart, for they are life to those who find them and health to all their flesh. Do you realize that the Hebrew word for health there is medicine? And what is medicine? God's statutes, his commands, his word. His word, if you keep them in, if you keep his commands in front of you, his stories, his admonition, his rebuke, his counsel, his correction, his encouragement, his advice, if you keep it in front of you, it's medicine to what? To your health. Do you realize that much of what happens in our lives is based on the way we live and the decisions we make? I mean, come on. How many times have you heard a doctor diagnose something, but then when they get more into it and you say, what can I do about it? They say something like this. You need to stop being so stressed. And then you go, I'm stressed about being stressed now. And now I'm in a catch-22. I've been there, done that. And it wasn't until God's word healed my body that I could really be healed. I need to give testimony to this. Do you realize listen to me very closely. My autoimmune system was so out of whack. I was seeing a pulmonologist because I couldn't breathe and I couldn't play with my son who was 2 years old. I was seeing a gastroenterologist because I was literally rotting from the inside out. I was seeing a rheumatologist because my joints, my immune system had attacked my joints so much that my wife had to help me put my underwear on, and I was seeing an internal medicine doctor that was tying all my care together. And I didn't know what was going on either today. All I know is that God's word healed me. God's word healed me. Amen. And I'll never forget what the doctor said when he said, I don't know, just sometimes these conditions just reverse. And I go, glory be to God, amen, who is mighty to save, and he is health. And so you say, how will it be healthy for me? Maybe you're struggling with anger, and God's word will speak to that anger. Maybe you're struggling with envy and covetousness and competitiveness. How much will that affect your health and your emotions and your marriage? Do you know, when you're struggling with competition and trying to keep up with the Joneses and always comparing yourself, there's no joy in the home. There's no joy in the home. And so God's word is saying, I can help you with that. And there's certain verses that I can speak to your life about that. Amen? And so as we go to the end, I want to remind you of this.
If you want to know how God's word can apply to you and how you can make it make sense and how it can speak to you, and you're having trouble with that, I need you to get the Holy Spirit involved. How so? Well, the Bible says this: these things I have spoken to you while being present with you. This is Jesus. He says, I've been teaching you while I've been here. But watch this. But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you what? All things. And so you have this amazing Helper. You don't need me. Can I tell you, when you have a problem, so many times people call Pastor. Let me call Pastor, see what he thinks. Can I tell you, you don't need me. In fact, I'm going to stop answering. No, I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. I'll still answer. But how much more effective is God? God knows you intimately. He doesn't slumber. He doesn't sleep. He never gets tired. He watches over you. You're the apple of his eye. He loves you. He died on the cross for you. He paid for you with the highest price, the price of his son's blood. And he loves you. And so when you call out to him, you say, Pastor, but he doesn't give me an answer right away. You give me an answer right away. That's because you won't let me off the phone. My answer is usually like, go pray about me. Like, no, Pastor, what do you think? Who cares what I think? Think about this. I'm just a man. So I throw an answer out there to say, whew, get off the phone. No, I don't do that. But I mean, right? Let's just think about this human-wise. Let's say you catch me in between something, and I'm like, yeah, okay, and I'm cooking, or I'm dealing with my kids, or I'm like, how about God has sole attention on you? He's been watchful over you since the day you were born, and he loves you, and he has his angels guarding over you, and he knows you intimately, and he knows exactly what you need when you need it. If you would only trust him for it, trust him for it. You say, yes, but he doesn't always speak this way. Yeah, he speaks this way. He speaks this way. And when you start opening up your Bible and you start reading it and allowing the Holy Spirit, you will be blown away. Amen? Because he cares for you. And so I've got one last story, and then we'll be done and we'll be out of here. Amen. I get two last stories, one from the Bible and one from personal experience. And the one from the Bible is, you got to be careful, because in today's day and age, you're going to hear a lot of advice. And some of it claims to be godly. Not all of it is. And so there's a story in 2 Chronicles 18 about two kings. And one of them is from the kingdom in the south, and one of them is from the kingdom in the north. The one from the south is called Judah. The one in the north is called Israel. The one in the north is headed, the king is Ahab. The one in the south is who? Jehoshaphat. Now, Jehoshaphat was a good king. He was a righteous king. The one in the north, Ahab, was an evil king. And he had a very wicked queen that it was more evil than him. Who was his queen? Jezebel. You've heard that name, Jezebel? Well, this was his queen. Now, they become relatives through marriage. Okay, they become relatives through marriage. Remember, that wasn't uncommon back then. You would have one of your children marry one of their children, they become relatives. And so the king in the north, the evil king, comes to the king in the south and says this. Next one, right there. Jehoshaphat was rich. King Ahab came to him and said, will you go with me against Ramoth-Gilead? Ramoth-Gilead, we want to attack them. We want to fight there, and we need your help. And what does the king in the south say? Jehoshaphat says this. He says, I am as you are, and my people are your people. We will be with you in war. So yes, count on us. Is that wise? Probably not. So we know right there, God's word could have helped him. Never does he inquire of the Lord. Never does he go to the prophets. Never does he go to the word. You know what's so interesting? Now you don't have to go find a prophet. You can go straight to his word. And you have the power of the Holy Spirit. But he doesn't do this. He commits to it. And then once he's in it, he says, maybe we should ask of the Lord. And so he tells the king Ahab, he says, do you have any prophets? He goes, oh, I got a bunch of them. I got 400. That sounds pretty good. Let's see what they got to say. Guess what they said? You're going to win. Oh, king, be blessed. You're going to win. Doesn't it sound like what most preachers are preaching these days to most people? Yet, we're living more sinful and more anti-God's word, but everybody's saying, God wants you blessed. God wants you healthy. God wants everything good to go for you. Everything is a bed of roses. Peace, peace. And yet God's word has said there is no peace when you live in certain ways. But that's a message for another day. Today we're talking about Ahab, right? And so then Jehoshaphat gets a little smart and says, whoa, 400 prophets all say the same thing in unison, like a choir? Speaking of, be part of the men's choir. All right? Like a choir, they're saying, you're going to win, right? He says, don't you have one prophet that can really hear of the Lord? I'm not feeling this. And then Ahab, watch this. He says, yeah, there's one guy, but he's a real downer. He never speaks good of me. I hate the dude. In fact, I've thrown him in prison a few times. And he goes, well, go get him. Yeah, I can find him real easy. Get him out of prison. Let's talk to him, right? And he goes, Micaiah, what say you? He goes, you're going to win. Go for it. What do the other guys say? They say you're going to win, then you're going to win. Jehoshaphat says, no, tell me the truth. He says, you want the truth? You're going to die. You're a dead man walking. And the Lord is judging you. Wow, Pastor, that's a good way to finish a message. That's like, go and be blessed. No. What does that have to do? What I'm trying to share with you is we see the same advice to Timothy, the young protege of Paul. He says, I charge you, therefore, before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who will judge the living and the dead at his appearance. Preach the word, be ready in season and out of season. Convince, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and teaching. That means the good, the bad, everything. Take this word and don't cherry pick. Make it come to life to people, because there is a time coming when they will no longer endure sound doctrine, but according to their own desires, because they have itching ears, they will heap up for themselves teachers that will make them feel good about turning away from the truth. And they will turn aside to fables. But you be watchful in all things. Endure afflictions. Do the work of an evangelist. Fulfill your ministry. That means get after it, Timmy. Get after it. It may be 400 to 1. It may be the entire world saying everything's good. But you know what my word says. Stand on my word. Believe in my word. Let my word be your lighting guide. Amen. Do not just go along to get along. Be stronger than that. Be bigger than that. Be more faithful than that. And understand that I love you. I do love you. I'll be with you. Amen? So we want to stand on God's word and trust it with all we have. Because at the end of the day, his word is about salvation. But not just the day he saved us, but our entire life. Our entire life. Listen to what Jesus said when he announced himself. He quoted from Isaiah 61, and he said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because the Lord has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. Do you realize we were poor and now we're rich? And his word reminds us of that. It reminds us of that. To preach good tidings to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted. If you have a brokenhearted, God's word will heal it. To proclaim liberty to the captive. If you feel trapped, God's word can set you free. You realize I've been studying anxiety here lately, and what I've been understanding is much of anxiety is because you feel overwhelmed of too many things coming at you, and you don't know which way to go, and yet God's word says, I'll show you which way. I'll make it simple for you. We weren't meant to be complicated. We're sheep. And the shepherd wants to call out and say, here, let me guide you. I will lead you beside still waters, and you'll lay down in green pastures. What else does the Bible say here? to proclaim the liberty of the for the captives and the opening of the prisoners for those that are bound. Let's keep going. To proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord, the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort those who mourn, to console those who mourn in Zion, to give them beauty for ashes. That means whatever you're hurting, whatever your issue is, whatever you're struggling with, God will exchange it. He'll say, give me your hurt for my peace. It's right here in this word. But you've got to be willing to let go of your ashes, and he'll say, I'll give you joy. Basically, watch this. That they may be called trees of what? Planted, that they may prosper. So I'll finish with this. The other day, second service, two servicemen sitting right over here. They were in fatigues. They were enlisted, and they were passing by, and for whatever reason, God drew them to this church. Do you realize that we believe in the power of prayer because the Bible tells us that God answers prayer, and we pray openly. We pray. If you're not, join us. We pray that God would draw people to this house. They don't know why, but they came and they sat right there. And as I preached, I could sense that some of what I was saying needed to be tailored for what God wanted to say to them. Didn't know exactly what. They were out there in the foyer after I'm meeting people, and the Lord spoke to me and said, you're not done. Go and speak to the servicemen. They're buying things at the cafe. Incidentally, our cafe always treats our servicemen, says, your money's no good here. Whatever you need is on the house. Amen? They serve us, we serve them. And so they're there, and I go up and introduce myself, and they're just overwhelmed. Oh my goodness, you would come to us. We were going to go to you, Pastor, but we were hungry. I said, don't worry about it, I came to you. I love you. What's on your heart? I just feel like the Holy Spirit wants me to ask, what's on your heart? You know, it's interesting because so many times we say, Lord, lead us, Lord, lead us, Lord, lead us. And then he does. And then you say something like this, well, Lord, I don't know, but if they come to me, if they come to me, ever been there? If they come to me, but God is saying, I want you to go to them. And so I go to them, and they were literally, that meant something to them. So they stop whatever they're ordering, and they said, we need to talk to you. They take me aside, I take them aside, and we're in a quiet little corner right back here by my office, and I began to share the gospel message with him. And the young man who was a redhead looks in my eyes with those blue eyes, and he says, I've never been in church. I don't really know what you're talking about. But I will tell you where I'm at. I'm really struggling. And I said, you're angry with God? He goes, yeah, a little bit. I don't know how he put it, but yes. He said, I lost my mom and my dad. I bounced around from foster home to foster home, family member to family member. Everyone in my life has been taken from me, even those relatives, friends. I joined the service, and I've lost friends, and I can't make sense of this. And I'm so hurt, and with tears in his eyes, I began to share the gospel with him about how God loved him and God wanted to change his heart and change his life and give him a brand new start. And so I opened the word and I began to just, look, read right here with me. And as he read right there, I could sense something in him happening, and tears started to well up. And I saw the miracle of God's word. Right there, in an instant, things began to change. In an instant, things began to change. Someone that had never heard it, someone that was being exposed for the first time, someone that was understanding it, someone whose heart was being transformed right there, right there. I said, would you like to accept the Lord as your Savior? Would you like to surrender your life to Jesus Christ? This is what it means to repent and believe. Yes, I would. We all knelt down, all four of them. Him and his friend, they accepted. Steph and I, we sat there and we led them through the plan of salvation. With tears, we got up, we hugged each other. He hugged me so tight. He said, thank you. Thank you. Henry was there to give him a Bible. And then I got to leave because third service was starting. Steph got to remain and minister to him and said, you know what? I've also lost both my parents. And I was right out of high school, not knowing what was going to happen and what life was going to do. And I came to play basketball on this basketball court. And that guy that just prayed with you prayed with me because God led him out of his office to come pray with a group of teenagers that at first glance said, no, we're good. We don't need prayer. You know how stupid that feels when God, you go, God told me to come pray with y'all. And they go, no, we're good. Well, one of y'all needs prayer. I didn't say that. I said, I think someone needs prayer for future and family. And that day we committed to be Steph's family. We committed to be Steph's family. And now Steph is ministering to this young man and says, you may feel like you don't have family, but you're wrong, you have family. And we are your family because that's what God does. So do you hear me? God is doing something amazing and he wants each and every one of us to play our part if you would only trust his word. And so this something amazing took place in an instant. This word changed his life. Now what if he says, okay, it changed my life. I'm good now. I'm going to go on my own now. Amen. And, amen.
The tears came again, and I just said, God bless you. And he and his friend walked away.
This is what we get to do, guys. We get to love on people. We get to share the goodness of God's word. So he came to the Connection Center, for those of you who didn't hear, and we got to bless him with a book. And Miss Julia was there to see him with tears in his eyes receive that book of God's word. What am I saying? I'm saying, look, if it's good enough to change your life, it's good enough to lead your life. Amen. Amen. Keep it close to your heart. If you're here today and you're saying, I need that hope that you've been talking about. With every head bowed and every eye closed, would you just raise your hand and give your life to Jesus? I see your hand. I see a hand right here. Another hand, other hands over here. I see a hand back here and right here. Right here, I see a hand with the green stripes. I see hands over here. Young man, I see your hand. I see your hands. Oh, there's hands going up all over. Glory be to God. Glory be to God. So the Bible says, repent and believe and be baptized. Be forgiven of your sins and saved. Pastor, how do I repent? Right here, right now, say, Lord, I've been living for myself or for other things. And I ask you to forgive me as I give you my life. I receive by faith your gift of life and light. Forgive me of my sin. Change me, rearrange me, and make me yours. Holy Spirit, come in. Seal me and guide me through eternity. In Jesus' name, I'll never be the same. Amen. 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 If you prayed that prayer and you don't have a Bible, come see Miss Julia. She'll give you one. She'll be right here at the Connection Center, and she's sitting right here in front. Would you partake with me? Father, we get to partake in celebration of your great gift on the cross. Thank you for your body that was broken for us. And thank you for your blood that was shed. In Jesus' name. Amen. Church, I love you. Have a great, great week.